feed. We're recording. We are about to go live. Everybody ready to go live? Quiet on the floor. So I'll give you, you're going to do your thing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll give you the hey ho sign.
It's time to fall into coding. We're talking about coding in the classroom. We'll have music from Nick C. And also the Google tip of the week. That's next on EduTech Guys Radio.
It's a good killer. It's my
I hit it and then my finger bumped it. I was like, oh my god!
I thought it was me. I was like, oh, did I do that?
Hello and welcome. Wow, that was loud. Hello and welcome to EduTech Guys Radio, brought to you by Southwest Arkansas Education Cooperative and Hope Public Schools, both located in Hope, Arkansas. I'm one of your hosts, David Henderson.
And I am Jeff Matlock.
There you go. Welcome to the show. Hope everyone is hanging out, having fun. We're going to talk about coding today, man. That's going to be cool.
I'm excited about it.
Yeah, I think it's going to be...
Yeah. I'm thinking of a coding. I'm thinking top secret coding.
That's coding.
It is coding, isn't it?
Well, I was thinking of, you know, like on top of a donut, they got the coding. Oh, wait, that's icing.
That was really loud. Don't make me laugh out loud.
Oh, man, you are listening to radio.edutechguys.com. You can also find us on mixler.com/edutechguys, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Voxer, Hoop the Hoop, you name it.
You name it, that's where we're at, huh?
Just put in the slash EduTech Guys and that would be us. Except for Google Plus, you got to add the little plus.
The little plus.
The little plus. Not the big plus, it's a little plus.
Hey, don't forget to catch us on Voxer, because I've actually updated a few things on there. For a second there, everybody thought we probably went offline because I got really quiet. So that was one of those things that we got to work out on. So yeah, listen, catch us on Twitter always. Twitter.com/EduTechGuys. Facebook.com/EduTechGuys. Go to the website. Please visit our website. Here pretty soon, I heard that the Blog Fairy will be visiting the website and updating the blog.
The Blog Fairy.
I heard it. I heard it from the Blog Fairy himself.
Oh.
Yeah, his name's Ricky.
Ricky the Blog Fairy?
That's what I named him.
Oh, okay.
He's a puppet.
All right.
That's a whole nother show. So, yeah, I got that fixed out. Someone was telling me my audio sounded a little crazy. I hope my audio is a little better now. I think I might have gotten it fixed.
Like my cat.
Yeah, like the cat. Whose cat? My cat. So, yeah, today it's time to fall into coding. We're pretty excited about it. David has a lot to share.
Holy crap. Is there anybody still listening to us at this point? Oh, my God.
Can you,
sorry, folks.
Can you talk a little bit about what's going on in coding with you?
Yeah, I can, or I'm going to anyway. My boss made an executive decision earlier today that we're going to talk about it. So let's talk about it. A couple of weeks ago, I was in Washington, D.C. with code.org. And I was learning how to be one of their professional learning partners and learn. I'm a good chunk louder. I learned how their system of what it means to be a professional learning partner manager, program manager, with their system. And essentially, what we're going to be doing is working with districts in our service area and potentially around the state, helping them incorporate computer science curriculum into the computer science courses that are currently being taught as part of the Arkansas K-12 computer science initiatives. So yeah, it's going to be very, very cool. And a lot of that, where we're going with today's the theme of today's show is a lot of that is built around coding. Now, computer science is way more than just coding. And I know a lot of people, when you hear computer science, that's what you think. You're thinking, you know, little screens with scrolling green text and the whole matrix thing and all that. And yeah, that's definitely part of computer science. But computer science it's really way bigger than that. You know, computer science, you're talking about things like, well, heck, the GPS that you find in your tractors these days. You know, you're talking about things like really cool inventions like LettuceBot. If you've not heard of LettuceBot, it's this big rolling robot that uses cameras and, yes, programming, but all these different systems within it, and it rolls along where the lettuce is planted, and it analyzes what's happening at each of the spots that it goes over, and then it administers whatever it needs to administer to that spot. For example, if it analyzes the soil, you know, as it's passing across and realizes that there's not enough moisture, you get water. You need whatever, you know, I don't know what's involved with the growing of lettuce. So but whatever that may take, whatever part of the process is required for that particular head of lettuce at that particular spot, this robot will either administer it or notify the farmer who, you know, hey, you need to look at this one. Something's not right here, or, you know, whatever. I mean, it's so computer science is way bigger than just coding. We're going to talk about this tiny little sliver of computer science called coding. That although it's a small sliver of computer science, it's kind of what hides behind the scenes when you pull the curtain back. It's what makes all the computer science stuff work.
Happen.
It makes it happen.
So, code.org. That's it.
That's it.
That's our first one. I just said, code.
No, yeah. So what's really cool, as of this moment, at least I don't think, I believe this to be true at the moment I'm saying this. They currently have two major curriculum programs that they roll out. One is AP Computer Science for high school students. And then they have another program that they roll out that is aimed at middle school students. And it takes various concepts and ideas about programming and incorporates those into lessons that the students can do and learn how to code, learn how to program. Again, it's much more than that, and we're going to talk in a little bit about some of the benefits of coding in the classroom. But it teaches those same skills that we will be talking about. For example, things like critical thinking, things like troubleshooting and debugging, and we'll talk about that stuff more. But that's incorporated in those programs, and then they're also in the process of rolling out an elementary program that will have curriculum. So really, it's going to be the whole spectrum. Pre-K, technically pre-K 12, although really it's pre-K 12 and beyond.
So is the idea to train teachers first and then train students, or train teachers first a little bit and then train them side by side?
It's the way their program is rolling out. They have a program that they hold each summer, and these are regional programs, and they call them TeacherCon. And so, like, part of my job is going to be go out and recruit not K-12, but 7-12 teachers who are either already teaching computer science or who will be teaching computer science next year, or who want to teach computer science next year and can get all of the state requirements and all that kind of stuff. But we gather up those teachers and we take them to this TeacherCon where they learn how to take the code.org curriculum and put that in their classes. So then the teachers then become the facilitators for that student learning. So it's not exactly teachers first, students second, although in a way it sort of is, just because the teacher con happens in early summer when the students are out of school.
Right.
So.
Right.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
It is very cool. I'm very excited. I think it's going to be really neat to see how this manifests itself in Arkansas.
So code.org, Hour of Code, which is coming up in December. I think it's December 5th through the 11th. Those days you schedule inside it, organizations, schools,
exactly,
libraries. Anybody can pretty much organize an Hour of Code.
Sure.
Because I think what it is don't they provide some one-hour tutorials, and they're available in like 45 different languages.
Yeah.
For like 180 plus countries around the world. So kids can get a little taste of coding in that Hour of Code. And if you ever want to visit it, just go to hourofcode.com.
Right.
And you can visit their website. And right there, I think if I'm not mistaken, you can actually register, you can organize your own hour of code right there.
Yes.
Now, here's what's really cool is a lot of schools have already done it, and then David, the co-op here, is going to, you know, sponsor and help organize some of it. Probably won't have to organize anything because most of the schools have already done that or are in the process of doing that.
Right. We've got, in our particular service area, we have 9 school districts, and of those 9 districts, 5 of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I'm just counting, making sure, 5 of those districts already have code, hour of code programs lined up. So I'm going to be working with those districts. I'm going to reach out to those districts that already have it signed, you know, that already have registered, and help them with whatever they need in terms of getting it rolled out and that type of stuff. And then also reach out to the districts who haven't signed up yet and see if there's anything I can do to kind of help them, you know, push that along and say, hey, this is something that's going to be really cool. And each district will, you know, they handle it differently. They want to do it differently. As Jeff had mentioned, you know, this is a worldwide program that's going on. There are currently over 22,000 hour of code registrations for That Week in December worldwide. Absolutely amazing. I mean, it's
well, you know, and there's the crazy thing. You know, what is it? It's just the hour of code is there. It's 1 hour introduction tutorials to computer science to help, you know, kind of demystify the idea of code, to help kids, you know, maybe get them interested in it and show them so they can learn the basics and help broaden their participation in like the field of computer science.
Right. And okay. Oh, I was just going to say, what's really cool about it is they use, if they're doing it through the, well, if you go to the Hour of Code website and you go and you participate in their programs, they have their coding environments are drag and drop. It's very easy to understand. It's but what's really cool is it uses things like Frozen, so you can draw. I'm going to get a little technical, but you can draw really cool fractals using Elsa and Anna.
Snowflakes.
All right, so you can draw snowflakes.
Star Wars, Minecraft. They have art stuff.
It's very, very cool.
I think they have Angry Birds. Make a maze or something like that. Make a Flappy Bird game. That was one last year. I think they probably still have that one. And then it actually, they partner with other stuff. So there's even stuff on JavaScript to work with older kids so they can learn a little bit more about JavaScript and things like that. So it's, you're right, it's a really pretty big deal.
Yes, and again, different programs are being rolled out different ways. So the Hour of Code, that's what it is. The idea is that these programs are basically slotted to take about an hour's worth of time. And really, from our experience, what we saw last year, they're not quite an hour, so they really fit into a class period really nice. If you're on a 45 to 50 minute class period schedule,
or like a recess period,
Exactly. Or if you have students who already go to a block, this could be their block.
Well, and here's the kicker: you don't have to do it during the Computer Science Education Week, which is December 5th to 11th. You can do an hour of code anytime you want to. So you can, you know, sign up for one, get posters for it. Code.org will, you know, help you publicize it, help you get it really rocking and rolling. And, you know, and there's that really crazy part. Everybody's like, where's this coding thing coming from? Because, you know, it's not brand new to education, but it's really gotten a huge bolster in the last, 18 months.
Whoa.
I mean, even bigger. I mean, well, look at Arkansas. They've now, so many states are rolling out computer science standards. And so now, boom, here's coding even heavier because it's one that we've already got in place. Thanks to places like code.org.
Well, and frankly, thanks to what the president has been wanting to push. You know, hashtag CS for all. Man, you follow that hashtag, and that's exactly what it is. It's computer science for everyone.
Right.
And it's this is coming from literally the top down. I mean, the president wants this, and then you have certain states, like Jeff mentioned, like Arkansas, where the governor immediately jumped on it.
Yep.
We now have a computer science curriculum specialist in place in Arkansas. Anthony Owen, we had him on the show before.
Wisconsin just released theirs like 2 days ago, entire state plan for computer science. We're going to start to see this really roll. And it's, you know, by starting early, by getting students in, preparing them for what's happening in the 21st century. And it's, you know, help nurturing problem solving and logic, creativity. That's what it does. So you might ask yourself, who can participate in it? Anybody. anybody can participate in RF code.
Yeah, anyone can sign up. There are schools, there are individual organizations.
Yep. Community-wise. You can do one at your church or civic group. The school groups could do it. It could be a student council thing. It could be a Spanish club thing. It doesn't really matter. You can have it anywhere. You don't have to know anything about code.
No.
It's all about the tutorials. What devices? Pretty much any device with a browser.
Yeah.
That's all you got to have. It'll work on any device. So any smartphone, any tablet, any web-based device, you're pretty much good.
Yeah. So it's very cool stuff. And like I said, you know, different folks are doing it differently. So in some schools, they pick maybe just the fifth graders, and the fifth graders are going to do Hour of Code. In some in some places, they're doing it, you know, I don't know, maybe they're doing it from 5th through 12th grade and they're having some kind of a competition or something. You know, I mean, there's all kinds of different ways that you can pull together an Hour of Code program.
And what's great is there's no sign-up for this. The kids don't have to sign in to do any of this. People, anyone participating in it, there's no sign-up or any of this kind of stuff. Now, what's cool is you can get certificates to give them when they finish it. So that gives you a little bit of something, you know, like, here you go, you've got this. Now, I'd suggest, you know, you don't have to have computers, but if you do have a handful of computers, teamwork works great. And you can put people together on a machine, let them work in groups of two or, you know, maybe larger. So there's Hour of Code. I mean, maybe we spent a little bit too much time on it, but it's coming up. And it's not just coming up. December 5th through 11th is the day, the week of Computer Science Education Week, which was a recognition of the birthday of computing pioneer Admiral Grace Murray Hopper. Yeah, I thought I'd throw that out.
There you go.
I put it in my notes here, so I throw that one out there. But yeah, so Computer Science Education Week, December 5th through 11th, we'll have just gotten back from AESA. We'll do a special show on that week about Computer Science Education Week.
Yeah.
And so look forward to that one. We'll see what tricks we have up our sleeves.
Well, exactly.
Because we might have some special guests or some students on the show or something like that. But yeah, so there it is. Hour of Code. Hope you like it. That one, that's one of our big ones. So here's the really interesting part. Want to take a little break and come back after we... So I tell you what, I'm going to drop it over to David and... I was just talking my fool head off here.
let's give everybody a chance to catch a breath. You can...
especially Jeff.
You know, grab one of your favorite beverages and a snack.
Too much sugar for me, that's what it was.
Enjoy a little Nick C, completely yours. That's what when I look at the clock, I was like,
we're talking about how it's you know, it's funny, I wish we could do it. If we did this, we warm up quicker now. Because, honey, I'm just vibing on your energy. We have no problem. But when you hear me, then we'll come back, we'll talk about our beliefs. That's really our beliefs. I know we have just begun. But I'm glad that we can give it. Seeing no better feeling out and falling in love. My heart is not my own. And it's sinking like a stone. I'm completely yours. I'm completely yours.
We're going to come out of this, going to that. Completely yours. Out of that, into our commercial. I'm completely yours.
Cross my mind, I think a bright moonlight and a glass of wine, and slow dancing on the beach to our favorite song. And if nobody's looking, we can get it on. But I know we have just begun, and I'm glad that we can give it a chance. 'Cause ain't no better feeling out than falling in love. My heart is like a stone. My heart is not my own. I'm completely yours. I'm completely yours. I'm completely yours. I'm completely yours.
You know, I know that if you look at it for a second.
I think it is audio.
When you look at me, the way my hair stands up when I hear you speak, the way my legs turn rubber when you love me down. I said, hey, little lover, can you hear me now? Well, I know we have just begun, and I'm glad that we can give it a chance. Cause ain't no better feeling out and falling in love. My heart is not my own, it's sinking like a stone, not completely yours.
Yeah, music from Nick C, Completely Yours, here on EduTech Guys Radio. Thank you guys so much for listening. Today we're talking about coding. We've talked about code.org. We've talked about Hour of Code. So let's talk about, at least from the opinion of these two guys sitting here anyway.
Our opinions.
Our opinion, not to be confused with Hour of Code, our opinion about some of the benefits of coding and computer science in the classroom. Why? Why are we doing this?
Yeah, we actually got into an interesting, not a heated, but well, it was a good debate.
It was a good
about
conversation.
You know, coding in the classroom. And you know, we hear that a lot, especially with computer science standards being pushed out the way they are now, and the president's push and education's push for computer science. But so this is, David and I sat down, we were trying to think of, you know, if we were to come up with a top five things, or if we come up with five things we think are benefits of coding in the classroom. The first one was the hierarchical processes, you know, the sequencing.
Yes.
You know, learning the process of, you know, beginning and end.
Right.
I mean, how many of us have been in that position so many times you would say, I don't know where to start.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we've also done a lot of work. Or you write a blog, or you don't write a blog. Or you write a blog.
Where's the fairy?
And you go, well, how do I end this thing?
Right.
Where's the end to this? And, you know, and that's a really interesting thing is, you know, ending a book, ending a mathematical sequence, ending coding, you know, beginning and ending, the process of where it goes, you know, where does this if fit? Where does this then fit? You know, where am I looping back to? Where does this go? That's a great thing to learn. It, you know, coding can help make that a little more rigid, I think.
Right.
And, you know, and then you can loosen that thing up when you get into other, you know, disciplines.
Sure.
But
sure.
Would you agree?
Yeah, well, yeah. You know, when we look at some of these concepts that seem very high level and seem very complicated and complex, hierarchical processes and sequencing, and all of a sudden, you know, people like wig out. You don't have to wig out. In second grade, my wife was teaching students how to take a story and in four story panels, put them in order so that you figure out what happens first, what happens next, then what happens, and what happens at the end. That's it. Guess what? They just did programming. They just didn't do, they just, you know, they did some programming. They used concepts of computer science. They had no idea. The teachers had no idea. What? Computer science? How's that computer science? Because you just built this algorithm, these hierarchical steps that gets you from point A to point B. Oh. So when you're coding something, you know, as the students are working on their code and developing their own programs or apps or whatever it is they're doing, those are the foundational type things that's what they get out of it. You know, you can't, this is one of the things I tell you, know, you can't build a house starting with the roof. Now, you may know what the roof is going to look like, and you have an idea as to when, or maybe you don't have an idea, but you have an idea as to when that house needs, to, or when that roof needs to go on the house, but you've got to start, when you're actually building, you've got to start at the foundation and work your way up to the roof.
Bingo.
So there you go.
I agree. And, you know, and that's... That so there's the hierarchical. That's our number one.
Number one.
Number one.
Well, we should have done these backwards.
Uno favorito.
Cinco favorito.
So teaches critical thinking and problem solving. That's our second one. Yeah. And David put that one down, and he's right on. So he's spot on, because just like you're talking about what your wife does in class, that's one of the other reasons she does it. Critical thinking and problem solving.
Right.
Because that's it. I need to make this Jawa walk across the screen and pick up a bucket and put out the fire on the R2-D2. I know that's a little, you know, but that's what it is. It also falls into the same thing, is that if a kid can figure out the critical thinking and problem solving inside coding, then when it's time to make a windmill that can lift a certain weight when the wind blows and pulls on it, then you know that whole process becomes a little bit easier for them, and vice versa.
Right. So, well, one of our very good friends, Ginger Lumen, tells the story, and I'll be honest, I hope I can do this without breaking down, because I mean, it is an amazing story, and I'm just going to summarize. But essentially, she had a student who had made a headband that had some electronic components to it.
Right.
And so it's one of those things like, okay, well, why did you make a headband? What's the deal with the headband? And the student said, well, I learned how to take these particular sensors because some patients with leukemia, they can't tell when they're not feeling well. They can't tell when they have a fever.
Right.
And so this headband will light up when their temperature hits a particular point, letting everybody else around them know, oh, she's got a fever. So critical thinking, problem solving, and ultimately, yeah, that student had to code that device in order to be able to, you know, how is that probe going to know what the temperature is? For that matter, what is the trigger temperature? And is that customizable?
Right.
Is everybody's temperature, right, you know, trigger at the same point?
Right. That leads to a long string of thought for that student.
Exactly.
That builds out constantly. Which takes us to number three.
Yeah.
It's okay to make mistakes, and that debugging your mistakes can lead to success. I mean, you know, that's a given. And it's funny, I don't think anyone's, if you've never coded, if you've never built a web page by pure HTML, if you've never done a doggone formula in Excel, you know, to get it to work exactly right.
Yes.
The moment that you do debug and you realize that, okay, that wasn't so bad, and I learned more about debugging, you know, about my code, mm-hmm, about my macro, about whatever I did, my formula I just written, by debugging it, And that can lead to more success.
Yeah.
Because then you find yourself debugging on the fly.
Well,
and it's not just in coding that you find yourself debugging.
No.
You know, is that,
right,
wait, is that a comma splice? You know, is that supposed to be apostrophe S? Or, you know,
right,
where am I at? Am I debugging on the fly? And it gives debugging a whole new meaning too, I guess.
Sure, absolutely. Well, and I think, to me, the reason why this made our top five list, from my perspective anyway, so much of, I don't know, life in general these days seems so centered on not failing, on having the perfect answer, the right answer, the correct solution the very first time you do it. And that's baloney. It's complete bunk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, things happen when you fail. That's, you know, that's kind of like the whole,
that,
like,
that only thing applies the first time is when you're dearming a bomb. But, you know, but besides that, you want to get it right the first time.
Okay, yeah. you probably wouldn't want to fail that first time.
But that's,
but that's by the same token, you only fail once.
Yes, true. Well, and I don't want my doctor debugging on me, you know, in the middle of surgery, but I know I'm getting out of it. I'm trying to be funny, but it's not funny. It's not coming off funny at all. It's coming off, shut up, Jeff. Let David finish his thought.
It's all good.
But no, you're right. You're right about that.
That's exactly, you know, students have got to be able to try and fail and tweak and try again and fail and tweak and try again and success and go, oh, and I see what I did wrong over here. You know, this is what we were talking about before the show started. I said, you know, One of the things I do here, one of my responsibilities is I teach teachers how to do different things. And so I've had a coding class, and I start at the very, very basic, the very beginning. You know, we're doing the Anna and Elsa, we're doing the Star Wars thing. You know, having them figure out, you know, those kind of baby steps, and that's where some of this failure comes in. It's rewarding to me to watch them fail, and I know that may sound cruel, but because I know that it won't take long before they do succeed, or, and this actually is going to tie into the next one, if they continue to fail and just can't get it and start banging their head against the table, guess what? they could go to someone else who did figure it out or has figured it out, or for that matter, they could, in some certain cases, do some research, i.e. Google or whatever, to come up with possible solutions, and they're no longer working alone. It's now collaborative. Mm-hmm. It now becomes an issue of teamwork, which that is our next point, so I'll let Jeff take
number teamwork. Four, teamwork. Help from other students and or resources to help reach the goal. That's just a big one. Teamwork is a big deal. And that's something that you wonder is the talk of most companies. What do companies work on more than anything? Teamwork. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's nothing wrong to reach out for help. And you know, you learn from each other. You make a team much stronger when everyone learns at the same speed.
Yeah.
And you know, everyone's going to have their, you know, there's going to be different stars throughout your team. So teamwork's a really big one. And I mean, I don't think we have to go into that one elaborately because it is what it is.
Well, but I do think it's important to note the shift. You know, if we think back to days before we were even born, you know, when you learn the history of computer science and coding, and a lot of that was, you know, one person, you know, in a room or in a cubicle or whatever, and they were doing all the coding. Now, yes, in some cases there were teams of people who helped kind of work together up to that point, but really when a push came to shove, it was one person who was actually doing the coding, and that mind shift has changed greatly. Now, in fact, one of the folks that works here at the Education Service Center where I am, her brother-in-law, yes, her brother-in-law, I think is what she said. Her brother-in-law is the CEO of this really cool company doing some really wild stuff. And he said, you know, I can teach somebody to code in the language that we use. That's not the problem. He said, the problem I have is I can't find people who can do the critical thinking. I can't find people who can work in a team to come up with a solution. Mm. You know, he said, this world is full of look at me superstars or wannabe superstars who don't know how to work together as a team.
Yeah.
And so I that's why this had to be on the list.
I agree. Makes you think of Big Bang Theory. Sheldon can never work except by himself. He's not a team player.
He is now, though. You know, they're working on their gyro.
You know, season 7. They better do something. Jumping the shark.
When they bring a pet and or kids, it's the end of the show.
Well, you know, Howard's about that. How did we get off on Big Bang Theory? Let's jump back to Cinco Favoritos.
Cinco.
The last one is literacy, reading and math calculations. And I think that speaks for itself. And David and that's one of the things that I was trying to express to David in our heated debate earlier was, I truly believe that it's another language. And the sooner we teach children to look at it as another language, mm-hmm. then that would be, you know, that's a really big deal.
Well, and also to the point that coding and computer science is not a class unto itself. I mean, it is, or can be, yes. However, those concepts, as we have mentioned, sequencing, critical thinking, problem solving, you know, making mistakes and debugging, teamwork, that applies to subjects across the board. It's not just this siloed, you know, computer science is its own thing. No, it's actually, you can integrate it into all the disciplines across the board, whether it's literacy, math, science, okay? What about the other humanities? Or just talk about humanities in general. Writing and acting and art and music. Yeah, computer science can go into all of those things. And they are part of all of those things.
Exactly. And I think that's... So there it is. Our benefits of coding, our five for that is the hierarchical processes, teaches critical thinking and problem solving. It's okay to make mistakes. Debugging your mistakes can lead to success. Teamwork, help from other students and our resources to help reach the goals. And finally, literacy is reading and coding and math calculations. Hey, we'll put these out on the old Twitter And maybe you have a blog article to maybe talk in depth about them down the
road.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So, hey, Jay, we're going to take a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back after these messages. It came up.
It wouldn't start.
It's like, what? What's going on? My wife does it again. She calls right in the middle of the show.
Well, that's good. My wife texted me, let me know that she bought me a sweet tea. I'm like, well, that's great. I have a radio
show. I'm in the middle of every.
Live during the conference or event to provide man on the street interviews and insights each day. Want to know more? Reach out to us on Twitter.
15.
At EduTechGuys. Head over to edutechguys.com and fill out the contact 10. Form on the front page. Or you can call us at 870-729.
I'll say where you want to know where we're going to be. You do it.
Thanks for listening.
You hit the first one.
See you soon.
Hey, welcome back. Yeah, hey, catch us. You want to catch us, call us and get us to your place, because that would be something we'd love to do. Hey, well, you know what? We're coming up live next week, in fact.
That's right. Next week, we are going to be at the Arkansas Conference of Technology in North Little Rock. That's October 19th through the 21st, providing all-day live conference coverage while we're there.
If you're there, come and see us. Hey, then, November 6th through the 7th in Hot Springs, we'll be at Schools Without Walls, which we're really excited about that one. That's at the Hot Springs Convention Center in Hot Springs, Arkansas.
And then from there, November 30th through December 3rd, we head over to Savannah, Georgia for the AESA National Conference. And again, that is going to be live conference coverage the entire time we're there. That's going to be very cool.
Yeah, you know what else is really cool? FETSI in Orlando, Florida. January the 24th through the 27th, 2017. That's also live conference coverage the whole time we're there. If you've never been, you need to head out to FETSI, head to Orlando. A lot of educational technology going on there. And hey, we'll be there.
That's right. And speaking of FETSI, we'll actually be featuring some of the presenters between now and the time the conference rolls out. We're going to be catching up with some of those folks that are going to be presenting during that particular conference, and we'll have them on the show between now and then, so definitely hang out and stay tuned for that.
Yay!
Yay! And now, you know what time it is?
What time is it, David?
It's time for Google Tip of the Week!
Hey, so the Google Tip of the Week today comes from Google. If you haven't checked out their blog, definitely head over to Google's blog, which it changed last week. It's googleforeducation.blogspot.com. It's what the original one was, but it changed to...
Now I think it resolves to blog.google/education.
Yeah, or something. Just look up Google Education.
Google it!
And the cool part about it is just a few hours ago, they released a great article on helping schools transform together. And what Google has done is... they realized that schools, they've been working with schools, education and Google have been going hand in hand for quite some time, and they've been helping them improve and innovate with the help of technology. So every school is different, and we've all got different kind of problems, and Google's been listening. So they've made a new site called Google for Education Transformation Center. And at this site, they've done some really cool stuff. The first thing they did was they defined the elements of school change. The areas that really need to be impacted. And those are vision. They need to have a strong vision. That's pretty much what that comes down. Like, where are we going? You know, I was telling David earlier, we're at the point in education and computer science that we need to be planning curriculum for students that haven't been born yet.
Right.
That's really kind of where we are.
Yes.
The next one that they have is learning. School leaders empower their teams to create a set of instructional practices, curricula, assessments. They're getting down into the meat and potatoes of what you need. Designing curriculum, doing assessments. The culture, that's another big one. You know, creating rituals, creating stories, creating structure, you know, helping to make symbols that foster the culture of innovation and, you know, encourage people to learn about, you know, technology and learn, period, using technology.
Right.
The next one is technology. That's a big one. It's like, you know, how helping them get the technology that they need inside their school. And then professional development. You know, teachers, they do have a lot on their plates. And we can use all the help we can get into professional development. And it's funny, an educational service center like the co-op has been doing professional development for decades.
Right.
But it's changed.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And it's changed dramatically.
Oh, sure.
Or drastically. Or dramatically.
Dramatically.
The next one that they've added to this also site is a funding and sustainability. You know, they get what schools need. You know, sustainability is a great word to talk about. Okay, if we buy these devices here, you know, how long are they going to take us? And then the last one is community, because that's what's really interesting. Some things that might happen in one community might not happen in another community. Mm-hmm. And you've got to think about that. You know, rural versus, you know, city versus, you know, that's a really big deal. So if you want to check out some really cool stuff, just head over to edutransformationcenter.withgoogle.com. We'll tweet that link out. Yeah. So, but it's called the Transformation Center, and you can actually log into it. You can connect with others. There's a resource directory. They've got frameworks built for everything that we were just talking about. So if you want to click professional development, you know, they've already started building that stuff out. And they've got strategies for success in all the areas. So very interesting.
That's very cool.
If your school's looking, you know, if you're just now looking, in fact, we had a school just contact us about coming to visit about one-to-one. Hmm. I'm actually going to suggest that, hey, you guys should look at this site also,
right,
and see how this can help you, you know, make your move, because just going one-to-one does not mean you're integrating technology.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot behind it, and the dreaded P word, plan. You know, you got to have a plan for that. So that's a big one. But so there it is. Google's new transformation site for schools, Google for Education Transformation Center. That's a big mouthful.
It is a mouthful, and a lot of very, very cool information. Man.
And don't forget about all the cool things they changed in G Suite. So now you have the Explore thing, which, by the way, I've been using. It's pretty neat. That's some pretty cool stuff.
That's awesome. Cool.
Yeah. So, hey, it's been a great show.
Yeah, man. This has been great.
Wrap this bad boy up.
It's a wrap.
Mm-hmm. Hey, don't forget to visit us on the web, www.edutechguys.com. Drop down to the bottom of the page. You'll find a contact form there. You can fill it out and get in touch with us anytime, anywhere, 24/7. Also, check us out on Twitter.com/EduTechGuys, Facebook.com/EduTechGuys. Just name it. Just look up EduTechGuys on Google. You'll find us out.
That's right.
Hey, well, I'm Jeff Madlock.
I'm David Henderson.
Hey, we'll see you next time.
Clear.
Clear.